Hello, and welcome to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray. Today we're doing the show live. So just to let you know that, if I mess up, which, they can't do anything about it. So just know that we are live today. So that's, I was trying to remember the last time I did this live. I can't even remember. But today I was, the article that we're going to be talking about today with the author of this article really grabbed my eye, especially after the election. But I think there was so much in this article that I was so excited that the author could be with us today. And because of his schedule, this works out best that we're doing it live. It is Rob Greving. Did I say that right? Is it Greving?
Yes.
Okay, Greving.
Yes.
He teaches Latin and English grammar at a Maryland high school. He served 5 years in the U.S. Army JAG Corps following his graduation from the Dickinson School of Law. Welcome, Rob.
Glad to be here.
This article for Crisis Magazine, and I'll let the audience know, it's called The Roots of Our Disrespect for Life. First of all, why this topic and why now?
Well, it kind of been brewing for a long time. And, for those who haven't read the article, I go to the point that really the root of the abortion problem starts with basically our acceptance of contraception. And our parish that we go to is very strongly pro-life, and we do a lot for it. My wife, for example, she works with the Gabriel Project and everything, and at Mass, especially during October, because it's Respect Life Month, at Mass we'd have the prayers for an end to abortion.
Mm-hmm.
and then it would stop there, and it really, after a while, just started to bother me, because there's this silence, because the gist of the article is, the abortion comes from the acceptance of the contraception, and mm-hmm. unless we start realizing what a problem the contraception is, you're always going to have the abortion.
Mm-hmm.
You're always going to have that, as as I say in the article, it's sort of the fallback position there. So we've got to, I think we've sort of ceded ground on that, and because of that, we're fighting a much, now, as you can see, we're fighting a much larger war on it, because we've, as I said, we've sort of ceded most of our territory here on this issue.
Right. And I think, I think one of the things that we talk about, and that St. John Paul II talked about, was a contraceptive mentality. And people had a hard time understanding what he meant by that. What does he mean, a contraceptive mentality? How would you explain that to people?
Well, I think in a nutshell, it's the idea that the marital act, well, first of all, that the sexual act should be done in marriage, mm-hmm. not outside of marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, that act is not connected at all to procreation. So the contraceptive mentality is one which is that the sexual act is simply really, in a sense, for the pleasure of the two people, or just for one of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it's for that person's sexual pleasure, and has really no connection to family or marriage or procreation.
Yeah. And I must admit that that was one of the things that has kind of opened my eyes. And these are, I think these are obviously kind of, we don't see the effects and the seed, the effects of planting these seeds right away. And I think that's why so often we don't make the connections. I mean, does that make sense to you? So the idea is, birth control becomes legal, or I shouldn't say legal, but becomes kind of prolific in the late 60s with the pill. or the early 60s with the pill. And so then it's kind of like, well, you know, women should use this so that they can, you know, have control over the size of their families. But pretty soon it's affecting just the way we think about sex in general. And then it just actually separates procreation from the sexual act in the minds of our young people. I see that with students all the time, which just amazes me. You know, it's kind of like they think, well, you know, what do you mean if I'm having sex? I got to be open to life. Like, they don't understand that.
Yeah, right. I totally agree. And to be fair to them, I mean, you know, I don't want to kind of date myself. I mean, that's the way people have been brought up for almost two generations now.
Yes, yes.
You know, that's just how it's done or not done. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, you know, it's so hard when you're, that's the way it's introduced to you or taught to you, even from the youngest, when they first start whatever, you know, the sex
sure.
education or something in school, is that, well, one thing has nothing to do with the other, and these are people in authority and people you trust or whatever, and, you know, so you think that way, and it's very hard to, especially if you start living that way.
Right.
You know, I think it was Fulton Sheen who said, if you don't live the way you believe, you start believing the way you live.
Yeah.
You know, so you start living that way, and it can become quite a shock. I mean, it would be, I mean, maybe like telling someone, you know, you shouldn't drink coffee or something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, well, no, we've been doing that. I mean, I drink coffee, so I'm not saying that's coffee, but I mean, it's like, you know, if all of a sudden you start telling people, well, no, this can really harm you. It is just so pervasive out there, and you just don't think about it.
Right. And don't you think, though, that this is kind of the, how can I say this? This is kind of just how our society is as a whole now, not just with sex in general, but it is very much, having children doesn't seem to be a priority anymore, like family, you know, having a family isn't such a big deal anymore. In fact, a lot of young people are starting to think that, well, you know, kids kind of, you know, take away your freedom, they take away your money, they take away all these things. Why have them? I mean, do you see that all kind of playing in together?
Oh, yes. I mean, I remember, you know, when I was younger, and I was youngest of seven kids. And so, you know, when I started talking to my parents about I wanted to get married or whatever, not or whatever, but mm-hmm. so I wanted to get married. I mean, and their generation, so, you know, they were raised back in the 30s, you know, marriage meant family.
Mm-hmm.
If you were getting married, that meant that you were going to have a family, God willing. You know,
right.
Things, natural consequences can happen, but marriage meant family, so it was the idea that there are going to be certain roles in a family, and you would have to learn to adjust. And, you know, we were from a large family,
mm-hmm.
I guess back then, seven kids.
Mm-hmm.
You just kind of accepted that. Whereas today, and I do think, again, for the last, I don't know, maybe 40, 50 years, that's no longer a given at all. I mean, you start dating someone, you start talking of marriage, and, you know, whereas 100 years ago, there was no question of what that was going to lead to.
Right.
Now it's almost like, you know, peace talks or something. I mean, you've got to sit down, you've got, okay, well, how many kids are we going to have? And it's like, well, when are we going to have them? And, you know,
right.
You've got your career, I've got my career, how are we going to do all this stuff? And you can see where, I mean, how it's going to start causing some tension and things like that. And, it's just, but it is a given. I mean, it's the
right.
kind of a thing where people don't, they don't think that marriage means family,
mm-hmm.
and they definitely, I shouldn't say they, I mean, most people don't think that marriage means family,
mm-hmm.
or that it means any kind of, that whole adventure of marriage. I mean, marriage can become such a terrifying experience at that point that, well, we'll just start living together then and see how this works and, you know, one thing falls into the other.
Right. And I think you're right. It is this sense that I always talked about it when we did marriage prep classes, is don't get into marital accounting, you know.
Yes.
Okay, I did this. You did that. I did the, you know, it like, I took out the garbage, so that means you have to do the dishes. I mean, you know, we get so in wrapped up in these roles that we forget what it means to love one another. You know?
Yeah. I remember, we're kind of getting a little bit off the topic, and I remember one retreat I went on, and this guy was giving a talk, and he said, marriage is crucifixion on the installment plan. And I thought that really, but the thing is, what you've got to remember is it's the dying to ourselves that gives us life.
Yeah.
You know, so you're right. If you start, anybody who goes into marriage thinking that this is like a 50-50 mm-hmm. or even 100-100, it's just you give till you die, the other person gives till he or she dies, and and then we both give for our children.
Right. And I think that's the big piece of it. And when we look at contraception, abortion, a lack of understanding of what sex really is and what it means, so much of it comes down to this lack of understanding of self-sacrifice, or what, you know, the nuns said when I was growing up, the word we used all the time is mortification.
You're
you
right.
know, dying to yourself. What does that mean? Well, that doesn't sound like any fun. Who wants to do that? Right? I'm getting married because, you know, this person will meet every one of my needs and I will be in such love and joy. I mean, you know, so we just don't have a good understanding of what the joy that comes from self-sacrifice. We see that. And I think that's a part of your article, in the sense that why do people use contraception, right? Why do they, I mean, if we kept kind of peeling back the layers of the onion, you know, we would get to this very kind of individualistic about myself, what I want. And that's at the heart of so much in our society, not just sex, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's what drives our careers and so much of it. And there's also just a huge fear, because you're opening yourself up to the unknown. I mean, it's very much like a person's relationship to God. You know, I mean, C.S. Lewis compared it to most of us think of our relationship to God as almost like we're paying taxes. You know, I'll pay my fair share, but there's got to be something left over for me.
Right.
Whereas what God says is, no, you got to forget. I gave you everything.
Yeah, it's all
so,
mine.
You know, and it's not that God's selfish or anything, but he's trying to say, the more you give, really, the more you will be alive. And mm-hmm. in our marriages, I mean, you know, I think if you asked any happily married couple that's been married for any number of years, and if you were to say, did you know that these things were going to happen, if you had been told before you were married that these things were going to happen in your marriage, would you get married? You know, mm-hmm. that you're going to have to move, or that you're going to have to work so many hours, or like in my case, my wife thought she was marrying a lawyer and was going to be rich and happy, whatever, and then here I become a private school teacher and we're pinching pennies. You know, I mean, we've had certainly our, you have those share of crosses, and if you'd have been told before you got married, it would, you know, no one would get married, or very few people would.
Mm-hmm.
I just think that's true. But then on the other hand, you look back and you say, but those very things that have really put us through the ringer, or, you know, have made us stay, you know, I just have a colleague, one of my colleagues in work here, they just had a baby. The baby's been in the NICU for the last 2 weeks.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, he said they just brought her home. She's on oxygen. He said, we're not getting any sleep at night. You know, so if you were to tell somebody you're going to be going 3 or 4 weeks or 3 or 4 months without getting any sleep,
yeah,
you know, but, is you know, is he going to trade that daughter for 3 or 4 months worth of sleep? No.
No, yeah.
You know.
Exactly. And I think that's it. I think in your article, when you talk about, you know, contraception and kind of all the, what kind of brought us to that place, we really have gotten to a place that when you take God out of everything and you want to be in control of everything, you don't really know the joy of letting go and seeing what God has in store for you. And even in the suffering, the joy that will come out on the other side, you know. I just think we really, because we've lost God in the midst of all of this, we're just so much poorer in a sense, not just spiritually, but even in our physical lives, we're poorer, you know?
Yeah, no, I agree, because you don't, I mean, you just take the fact of, you know, when you're in a large family, for example, or, I mean, when you, it's just, you're in a family, you have to share.
Right.
You have to think of, well, somebody else has a different schedule or things like that, but then you realize that, you know, those things make you happy when you share.
Right.
When you know, you don't think of it at the time, you don't want to give your toy to your brother or sister, or you don't want to have to adjust your life to somebody else's, but then you sit back and at some point you kind of realize, but gee, you know, I would never, if I didn't have my brother or sister there, or if I, you know, those memories that I have of even having fights with your siblings and things like that, those can sometimes be the fondest memories that you have.
Exactly. So one of the things I know we're kind of expanding here, but you do touch on some of these things in your article. But, you know, how do you think we got from a society where technically contraception was, you know, was illegal?
Right.
And even in Christian churches, you know, we kind of got a crack in that. I think it was the Episcopalian Church.
The Lambeth Conference.
Okay.
With the Episcopalian Church, yeah, or the Anglican Church.
Right. And so they're kind of the first crack in the foundation of Christians standing together on this. But they, again, didn't, I think theirs was like only in severe circumstances,
right,
or something. How did we move from that stance to where we are today?
Well, it's the big lie, you know, or maybe it's the small lie that becomes the big lie. I mean, what you do is, I mean, it's portrayed in a very, like all lies, you know, go back to the first lie when the devil tells Eve, you know, if you eat this apple, you'll become like God.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I mean, you start out with this idea, and, you know, I mean, excuse me, no one's saying that raising a family is easy, or
right,
that having lots of kids is easy, or there's not a lot of suffering, or that there's not a lot of pain and
mm-hmm.
things like that involved.
Right.
But you start out with the idea, hey, you know, you can, you know, you can do this, you can get married, and here's the deal, you know, the slogan, every child will be wanted.
Mm-hmm.
But, okay, who doesn't want that?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a great thing. Of course, every child should be wanted.
Right.
Okay, but there's two ways of doing that. One is to just simply want every child.
Right.
You know, just love the child as yeah. Let's just start with that.
Right.
The other is to say, well, then only have children that you want.
Right.
You know, only have the number that you want or the type that you want. I mean,
right,
you know, Iceland just has this big boast now that they don't have any Down syndrome's children, because they automatically abort any child that comes up with Down syndrome on the ultrasound.
Right.
You know, I mean, so
yeah,
it starts out with putting that positive spin on a lie, which we know every sin is like that. Nobody commits a sin because he or she thinks this is a bad thing to do. There's some good with that. The devil always twists a good, an evil, to make it look like good. And
right,
you know, and this looks good. Oh, we're going to have our perfect three or four kids, and they're all going to be healthy, and then we're going to space them so we have enough money to, you know, you got to put them through college. I mean, you know, you have these people who sit down and they're getting married, and somebody comes along and says, well, you know, you're going to have to save about another $400,000 or $500,000 to put these kids through college.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, I'm fine. I'm only going to have one because I just can't afford to have any more than that, you
right.
know.
Yeah, yeah. God forbid they put themselves through college like I did. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. You know, or maybe they don't even need to go to college.
Yeah.
That's a whole
other
but
story.
But it starts to taint every single aspect of your life, because then you got to start to think, well, if we're going to have these kids, well, then both of us have to work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I'm not saying anything against families where both couples have to work, because these days that may just
be the way it is.
Be the way it is. But I mean, it spreads, you know, it puts these ripples through everything that you do. But then once you get into that thinking, it's very hard to get out of it. And as I try to point out in the article, it's tied to so many aspects of our culture right now. I mean, marriage used to be the big decision that you made in your life because it was the thing that was going to color every other aspect of your life. You were going to get married. You were going to have kids. So where are we going to settle down? I'm going to have to do a certain type of work. I won't be able to take this promotion or that promotion, or I may have to do it. You know, it colored everything.
Exactly.
Whereas now it's the reverse. My career and my needs color everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Not my family, not the needs of others, but my needs color everything else. And, you know, it's just, and I'm not, you know, I hate saying this because I'm not trying to put myself up as any virtuous person here, but I mean,
it's hard.
It's really hard.
I always say that, you know, that's what original sin's all about. Original sin is thinking yourself first, wanting what you want, you know, and so to say that isn't a part of every one of us, you know, it is. I mean, but it's kind of like, you know, one of the things that I kind of helped with in our diocese, and I have a niece trained in it, is she's a Creighton practitioner to help couples, you know, with natural family planning, but also couples that are struggling that want to get pregnant, you know, so she works with them in this. But it's, you know, and she says, I mean, she tells them, this is hard, you know, it's much easier to take a pill. You know, this is hard, but it's so much more worth it, and it's so much healthier for you, and it's healthier for your marriage because you must communicate. You know, she's trying to, you know, tell them all these wonderful things, but also tell them it's going to be hard. And the minute somebody says it's going to be hard, it's like we want to bail. Why would I want to do something hard?
I mean, maybe to kind of put this in perspective, see, my wife and I struggled with, this is a confession, we struggled with infertility. We were not able to have children, and that was a burden, you know. We eventually adopted, we have a beautiful son now. He's a senior, and that's been a struggle. But, I mean, it's back to that idea that marriage is this crucifixion on the installment plan, but really every vocation should be like that, whether you're the priest or you're living the single celibate life. I mean, it's got to be giving, or else you end up being a very sad, lonely person. And you're right, like the idea of just the communication in marriage. I mean, I think that's one of the great things about the natural family planning and things like that is, you're going to have to talk to that person about very intimate, difficult things here.
Right.
But when you do, boy, you feel so much closer to that person, and you realize it's us. It's you know, we are one. It's the two of us together here.
Right.
Rather than me going off into my corner and you going off into your corner.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think the idea, and maybe we've got about 3 minutes left here, Rob, in the first half of the show, but one of the things I think that our culture has become very much about convenience. We do look for the easiest way out, you know, and And so, you know, I think contraception plays into that. It just, it's so much easier, right? I don't have to think, or I don't have to track my fertility, or I don't have to, you know, I don't have to have these conversations. I just take a pill. You know,
right.
And do you think that that whole convenience piece in our society plays into all of this?
Oh yeah. I mean, let's face it, it is. It's a lot easier to just, this is where the selfishness comes in. It's a lot easier for the man to just say, hey, wife, this is your responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, you take care of that so I don't have to worry about it. But then again, that's where the abortion comes in, because then that's the next step of convenience.
Mm-hmm.
If one thing has not worked, well, here's my fail-safe. Here's my plan B.
Right.
Or whatever.
And that was interesting because in your article, which I didn't realize she actually wrote this, but you wrote, Justice O'Connor in Planned Parenthood versus Casey specifically said that abortion should be allowed because many women rely on it when birth control fails.
Yeah, that was part of her opinion, and she was just, I mean, to be fair to her, she's echoing the consensus of the culture. I mean, that was, you know, that was, when was that, early 1990s, I think, but that was part of the idea that, you know, see, that's how it started. Again, abortion was supposed to be safe, legal, and rare, but you know, that was the lie that they used for a long time. But, you know, now it's just the next step in the line. I mean, it's like if your burglar alarm doesn't work, well, then you should be able to, you know, if the bars on the window don't work, well, then you need to have the burglar alarm or mm-hmm. something like that.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So, and we're going into break here. And so I want the audience to know who we're talking to today. Rob Greving, teaches Latin and English grammar at a Maryland high school. He served 5 years in the U.S. Army JAG Corps following his graduation from the Dickinson School of Law. And we're talking about an article he wrote for Crisis Magazine entitled The Roots of Our Disrespect for Life. I think this is real important for us, especially after we're still kind of stinging from that defeat of the constitutional amendment. So I think we need to look at this in a broader perspective, and his article actually does that. So as we move into break, make sure you come back on the other side of the break as we pick up this conversation. You're listening to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray.
This is Franciscan Media's Saint of the Day for November 13th. Today we celebrate St. Francis Xavier Cabrini. Mother Cabrini has the distinction of being the first U.S. citizen to be canonized. Born in Italy in 1850, she desired to enter a religious congregation despite her poor health. In time, she founded her own small community, the Missionary Sisters of the Sacred Heart. Though she had long dreamt of being a missionary to China, Pope Leo XIII urged Mother Cabrini and her sisters to minister to the thousands of Italian immigrants in the United States. Difficulties and disappointments followed her at every turn. The Archbishop of New York even advised her to return to Italy, but she could not turn back. Instead, Mother Cabrini persevered, and in 35 years, she founded 67 institutions to serve the poor, the abandoned, the uneducated, and the sick. She organized schools and adult education classes for Italian immigrants to strengthen their faith. Her missionary work expanded to other U.S. cities and to Central and South America. In 1917, 10 years after becoming an American citizen, Mother Cabrini died of malaria in Chicago's Columbus Hospital, which she had founded. She was canonized in 1946. There's more about the saints, along with inspiration and Catholic resources, at our website, saintoftheday.org. From Franciscan Media, this has been Saint of the Day.
Annunciation Radio would like to thank and acknowledge the law firm of Klein, Cook, and Weisenberger, located on Route 20 in Perrysburg, for underwriting a portion of our programming today. The firm specializes in estate planning, with a focus on simplifying estate plans to keep costs down and avoid probate when possible. You may reach Matt Weisenberger at 419-321-6444, online at ccw-law.com. Thank you for supporting Annunciation Radio.
Hello and welcome back to The Virtuous Life. I'm your host, Pat Oedy-Murray, And today, our guest is Rob Greving. He teaches Latin and English grammar at a Maryland high school. He also served 5 years in the U.S. Army JAG Corps following his graduation from Dickinson School of Law. And welcome back, Rob.
Glad to be here.
We're live today, so if things sound a little different or I'm a little off kilter here with timing, it's because we're live. But I wanted to have Rob on because he wrote an article for Crisis Magazine entitled "The Roots of Our Disrespect for Life." And I think that I wanted to have him on because I think, you know, as a church, as a member of the church within the state of Ohio, especially, a lot of people are still kind of, you know, smarting, grieving, hurt by the passage of this constitutional amendment in Ohio allowing for abortion. And so I just think that this is such a bigger issue. And so when I started reading Rob's article, and I want to see if I can find this line that I can share with them so people you'll know why I had him on. It says, and this was October. October is Respect Life Month. In the minds of most, respect life means fighting abortion. And it is left at that. To leave it there, though, is to pull out the blade of a weed, but leave the root intact. And if you don't pull out the root, the weed will grow back. That's been kind of rolling around in my head in the sense that, of course, abortion is a great evil, the killing of these babies, and how we need to have a conversion of heart and mind for people. And so when Rob kind of attaches all of this to kind of this contraceptive mentality that, you know, and we've been talking about and why, you know, why is contraception such a big thing? Well, because, you know, we want things the way we want them. This sense of individualism and selfishness and not opening our minds and hearts necessarily to God and letting him, kind of take control of our lives and show us what true goodness really is. So I was just taken by this article. And so Rob was gracious enough to be on. And I thank you, Rob. You know, I know you put in a long day of teaching and then to do an hour show with me. So I remember those days of long days of teaching. One of the things, Rob, that I think that you mentioned in your article, and I want to talk a little bit with you about this. You go on to talk about later Justice O'Connor in Planned Parenthood versus Casey specifically said, oh, I talked about that one. I'm sorry. We talked about that before break. I missed my place here. But you went on then to say, the expectation of sex without consequences, as with other expectations, it soon becomes a requirement, a right. And that's kind of where we're at. We're having this discussion about a right to an abortion. How do we make sense of that? I have a hard time making sense that you have a right to an abortion.
Well, yeah, and I think that's part of where, speaking as, I guess, maybe as the former lawyer, you know, the law is not morality, but it certainly shapes our idea of morality,
mm-hmm.
you know, because we tend to equate the law with things that are right and things that are wrong. So if it's legal, it's an easy mental step to say that it's permissible or it's good. I mean, you know,
right.
It's like the whole situation now, I think, I'm not trying to tip my hat, but like the legalization of marijuana. Well,
right.
Then, you know, we're starting to find it's very hard with young people to say that this is wrong. Well, if it's wrong, why is the state sponsoring all these shops, you know, and getting all the,
yeah.
Well, that's a whole other thing. But I mean,
right.
You know, when you start to say that, you know, you create this expectation, and the expectation is that, you know, conjugal relations actually have nothing to do with having children or family or anything like that, well, then and it's a very, you know, awesome experience, let's face it.
Right.
It's kind of like a drug in a way. You just tend to want more of it, and you go where you want to go with that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the right to abortion, again, you got to realize that, for what, more than 50 years now, Roe v. Wade was in 1972. I mean, mm-hmm. when you start to tell people that this is a constitutional right,
right,
especially in America, where we at least for a long time, we so revered the Constitution. I mean, this was our big boast to the world, and it is. It's a beautiful document and everything. But
yeah.
So if this is a constitutional right, and then all of a sudden the debate is no longer about whether or not we have a life here, but whether or not I have a right.
Exactly.
And once I have this right, you're taking away my rights. And I did not follow the election in Ohio all that closely. I mean, I certainly knew what was going on, but, you know, let's face it, that's where the other side, like when the Supreme Court overturned Roe, it was just, you know, there was really no discussion of the legal intricacies involved there or the constitutional thinking that went on there. It was just simply, well, they took away my rights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's, especially to Americans, that's something that really hits hard at our core.
Yeah.
You know.
Rob, do you think it would be helpful in this? Because in my mind, I don't, when I teach this, I use, you know, the terms they give you, you know, embryo, fetus, you know, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the idea that this is a human being from the moment of conception, and scientifically that argument can be made very strongly. Would it help, do you think, in this conversation about, especially about abortion, if we talked about we're killing human beings? I mean, we tend to just, we talk about the preborn, we talk about, you know, fetuses, we talk about all this. But if we were just that clear, I had a friend of mine say, you know, well, I wouldn't take down, somebody that had a yes sign, vote yes, in their yard, but I'd be tempted to put up next to it, you know, I think it's okay to kill babies.
Right.
Right. And it was the sense that I don't feel like we have a discussion anymore about what it is we're doing. We just talk about the right, you know, and I don't mean to be vulgar or, you know, overly, you know, demonstrative about what this is, but we would never say that about anything else that you have. Well, yeah, if you don't want that person hanging around, you have a right to kill them. I mean, we would never say that.
I know. It's and that, again, is where we've kind of ceded the argument, I think, in some ways to the other side, because it's and this is where the kind of the grammar teacher in me is coming out, because it's, if you win the battle of the words, you win the argument.
Yes.
All right. It's like back when we were talking about traditional marriage. Well, if all of a sudden you start talking about traditional marriage, then what you're doing is you're saying, well, there are other kinds of marriages,
mm-hmm.
which is seeding the ground that, well, then we can have these other kind of marriages, whatever you want to call them. All right. You know, once you shift the ground from we have a baby here, we have a human being here,
right,
to a right of a person's self-determination.
Mm-hmm.
Well, especially in America, we are very much, and in a good way, we want to believe that people should have a lot of freedom, mm-hmm. and a right of self-determination. So if the issue is framed that way, then, yeah, you all of a sudden this child that's in the womb really isn't there anymore. He's not in our vision, but you're right. If you were to put up a sign saying, you know, I think just, you know, put up mm-hmm. a sign of a little fetus or baby, you know, mm-hmm. put up a sign of that baby in the ultrasound and then put a big X over him.
Right.
I don't want this.
Mm-hmm.
Whoa, you know, that's not going to sell.
Right.
And let's face it, the other side has been very good about
wordsmithing.
You know, put the argument on their terms, yeah. And I think we have to fight back with not uncharitable words, but right. You have to be blunt sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. I was just one, you know, because I just, you know, in class I always teach, you know, this kind of 4-point proof from Dr. Maureen Kondik on, you know, why this is a human being from the moment of conception. And scientifically, I never mention God. I never mention any of that, you know. And they're like, oh, you know. And so therefore, because once you grasp that argument and you really don't have a good counter argument, to it, you have really nowhere to go because you can't even say, well, somebody doesn't want it. Well, that doesn't make it any less a human being, you know. Or right. You know, or even how it comes into being, it is still a human being, you know. So I just think, I don't know, I just think we need to talk maybe a little bit more about that and maybe be clear. And you're right, I think, you know, maybe not give up that part of the argument, not let the other side define the argument. One of the things, Rob, because, you know, in your article, you certainly talk about this contraceptive mentality, and we talked about that in the first half of the show, but there, how did we get to the point where using, because now young people believe, as do, and not just young people, married couples, that using contraception is the responsible thing to do?
Well, again, that's part of the ad campaign, I think.
Okay.
You know, I mean, you start to tell people what is, you know, it goes back to what is marriage about,
mm-hmm.
Okay? And, you know, we talked about this at the beginning. I mean, it's like we have to go way back to what is a human being? John mm-hmm. Paul talked about this in the theology of the body and things like that. I mean, what is that other person? That other person is a person, okay, and there's a dignity attached to that person. And so, I mean, they say it's the responsible thing to do, but why is that? So you can have the life that you think you should lead with as few consequences as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not the Catholic or Christian way of viewing what life is about. Life is about giving yourself to God and letting Him work His plan in you. And so, you know, you start out, I mean, and this goes way back to, and I talk about that in the article, to the early, you know, early 20th century, late 19th century, when you had the whole eugenics movement,
oh, yeah.
You know, with this whole idea of, well, we want to have fit people.
Mm-hmm.
We only want to have the healthy children. And you know, I talk about Margaret Sanger's connection to the Nazis and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so it's the responsible thing to do because, well, you don't want to burden society with more children. You know, it's the whole idea that the earth is overpopulated, and if you have more than three kids, then somehow some person in Africa is going to starve to death,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, your other kids are not going to be able to have the love and attention that they deserve because, you know, there'll be more children in the home and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very persuasive argument.
Mm-hmm.
It certainly sounds good. And then, you know, there's just that little appeal to yourself deep inside where you're saying, yeah, this sounds really good. I can, it certainly helps me out. You know,
I
don't have to worry about whatever, three kids, five kids, nine kids or something. I just have to worry about this one and get him or her out of here, and then I'm free to enjoy, you know, retire at age 45 and
mm-hmm.
have fun for the rest of my life. And I'm sorry, I don't mean to be disparaging
no.
to people that do that, but it sounds very good. I mean,
it
most
does.
Advertisement does.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Well, and I think part of our you know, we see that sometimes the values that are put forward by the world stand in contradiction to the Christian
oh, yeah.
values. But I think part of that is we don't understand the joy that comes from following, you know, the kind of the virtuous life, right? Versus, you know, that the world, people that get enamored with worldly values usually end up lost, you know. And it may look good for a while, you know, it may all look pretty good, but at some point in their lives, they just kind of come up against the wall of what is my purpose? You know, what has my purpose been? Has it just been about me and my own fun and enjoyment, or is there something more I'm supposed to be about? And I think, you know, when you hear, I mean, I remember, you know, we had a president who said, I, you know, don't want my kids punished with a baby. I thought, yeah. I cringed when I heard that. I thought, I think you could have articulated that in a much different way. I knew that, you know, I was giving him the benefit of the doubt there, but just that phrasing made me cringe because I thought, no baby, whether wanted or unwanted, is a punishment. You know, it may not be, you know, it may not be a joy for a young unmarried woman right now in her life, but, you know, someone can adopt that child and have great joy. You know, so,
yeah.
And that's something nobody talks about hardly anymore is adoption. And when I was growing up, that was a big deal.
Well, I agree. And it's also one of these things, I think, as you said, you look at what's put out there in terms of what, you know, what is your life supposed to be like? What is, what's the end goal of life? And you see, and I'm not trying to throw stones at people, but you see the movie stars, you see the athletes and things like that, and it's about fame and glory, and it's about me being number one and all this kind of thing. But then every once in a while you get the story of, okay, so-and-so, who was the great film star of the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, or whatever, you know, died of a heroin overdose, mm-hmm. or, you know, and you see these people later on in life. And I, you know, I think of my mom and dad, who no one ever heard of, okay, except maybe a few people out of Fargo, but they certainly had a difficult life raising seven kids and everything like that, but I would take their life over any movie star or whatever out there, because, you know, you don't see the billboards of here's John and Jane Doe. They've been married 52 years or something like that.
Right.
They're barely making it by, but, you know, here are their kids, here are their grandkids, and they're smiling and they're happy. And, you know, that's, to me, that's what life's about.
Right.
Now, when you sell the other side to it, that life is about having the huge house, the, you know, the pool, the car, the vacations, and there's nothing wrong with that if you can afford it. I'd love to be able to afford it, but I mean, if that's what life is about to you,
right?
Okay, you can go get it, but I'll tell you what, when you get to be, I'm tipping my hat in, when you start to get to be about my age or something like that, you realize that a lot of that, it's nice to have, but that's not what brings you joy,
right?
You know, in the end, you're gonna, it's okay, now we're in November, so we start remembering the faithfully departed,
right?
You know, go to a graveyard and see how many of those people have their cars with them.
Yeah. Well, and I always say, the first, you know, 50, 55, 60 years, you're collecting stuff. And then once you hit 60, you keep giving away stuff. You want to get rid of it, you know?
Yeah.
Well, one of the things, too, that I want to get to, Rob, is because I hear this, and you make a statement in this in your article, too, and I keep thinking, how can we address this? You say contraception has become a gimme in our culture, one of those things that, of course, must be allowed and promoted. It is paid for by the government, and it's supplied in our schools. Many parents would be horrified at finding out their kids are smoking cigarettes than they would be if they learned their kids were using contraception. I've heard parents say this, and I cringe when I hear it. Well, they can't control themselves, so I, you know, it's better that they're on, you know, on the pill or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get parents to understand, you know, how to help their children grow in discipline and virtue versus, well, you can't, I know you can't do it, so just take a pill. I mean, have you ever had any success in dealing with parents that have that kind of a mindset?
At the school where I teach, I mean, we have a whole, that's like our kind of raison d'etre or whatever you call it. I mean, you know, it's the virtuous life, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what brings you happiness. Now, I mean, a short answer to what I would say to parents like that maybe might be something like, okay, maybe, so if they can't control their eating, give them this pill that's going to make them, that's an emetic, mm-hmm. that will make them throw up after every meal so that they can just continue eating.
Mm-hmm.
Are you going to do that? Well, of course not. You know, and that's a graphic way of putting it, but I
sure.
mean, they can't control themselves. Well, then, my gosh, is this, you don't want to condemn the parents because the parents are there trying, they're thinking, I want my child to be happy.
Right.
Okay. So you've got to get them to understand that happiness comes with virtue. And I think everybody has had some experience of that in their life. You got a pay raise. Why? Because you learn to work harder. You learn to discipline yourself in some way. Or you lost weight. Why? Because you learn to control your appetite or you learn to do some exercise. I mean, there's small steps here where you realize that doing the difficult thing actually makes you happier.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So if you want your son or your daughter to have a good marriage, you know, and that may be the first question. You would like your son or daughter to really have a nice, happy marriage, wouldn't you? Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, yes. All right. Well, let's follow the science here. Okay. Look at the people who have followed the church's teaching on this. And the statistics are there.
Mm-hmm.
And the examples are there. Their marriages maybe more monetarily stringent or whatever. I mean, they have to make a lot of sacrifices, but those people are happier. Their marriages last longer. You know, do you want your son or daughter to get married and have a divorce 5 years later, 6 years later, or 10 years later, or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I mean, if you want to just do the statistics and the analytics or whatever you want to call it, you can do that and show them that way. A lot of it has to go, though, and, you know, this is where, again, it goes way back to what are we teaching in the schools, what are we hearing from the pulpits, what are we hearing from the bishops, and I'm not trying to put the burden on them because ultimately, you know, the parents are the primary educators of the children.
Right.
You know,
right.
You've got to tell your kids, I mean, why are we able to send you to St. Pius X High School? Because we made sacrifices.
Mm-hmm.
It costs a lot to send you there, so we didn't go on vacation last year. Sacrifice leads to happiness here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why did your mom stick with me when I did these stupid things, you know,
mm-hmm.
or whatever?
Right.
Because sacrifice makes happiness. And you're right, there's that word sacrifice,
yeah.
It's mortification, and we cringe at those things, but... okay, you look at the crucifix, that's
yeah,
where it is.
I know. That's what I always say when people,
yeah.
you know, think life is tough. And I always say, well, look at the cross. This is what
yeah.
this is what we're all about. One of the things, let's see, how many minutes do we have left here? Three. Okay, we're down to about 3 minutes. Yeah, so I want to make sure I know where I'm at with one of the things that you bring up, which I think is just wonderful, and I'm just going to quote it, and then you can comment on it. But you see in the article, you may rail against abortion all you want, but once we've lost a sense of dignity for the man or woman we see, how can we have any respect for the dignity of the person in the womb we can't see? Any act corrupted at its beginning becomes more corrupt as it progresses. Hence our Lord's admonition that murder begins with anger. The sexual act, being one of the most powerful, if distorted at its beginning, becomes a tsunami of perversion as we see today. I thought that was really a powerful paragraph. Because... we look around and there is just a lack of respect and care for the people that like are in front of us.
Right, right.
That we do see.
And I think that starts with the idea that a person has to have some value to me that I can put on before I will respect that person. You know,
right.
The value of either a physical appearance, or a value of you can give me so much money, or a value of you can give me so much pleasure. That person has to have a value. And if you don't, which, you know, 9 out of 10 people that we meet probably don't fit that category. They're not, we don't think they're physically appealing, or they can't get us money, or they can't help me get a job. Well, then to heck with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, we don't say that in so many words, but we'll walk right by them on the street when they're down there, you know, the homeless person, or we aren't courteous to them in the grocery store, or we aren't certainly courteous to them on the highway as I live in D.C. You know, I mean, you know,
yeah.
It all starts with that person has dignity, period.
Yep.
End of discussion.
Right.
And that dignity starts when that person was conceived as a human being a long time ago.
Right.
Every person you see at one point was the same as that baby right after conception.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that this is, you know, it just spills over into everything. This lack of respect for life. You know, we're talking about it in regards to abortion, but when we talk about contraception or the way we just treat people that we meet, or when we see displacement in our world and fighting in our world and all these things going on, there is such a lack of respect for a person as a person made in the image of God. And we are out of time, so I want to let people know who we had today. Our guest today was Rob Greving. He teaches Latin and English grammar at a Maryland high school, and he served 5 years in the U.S. Army JAG Corps following his graduation from Dickinson's School of Law. And we have been discussing his latest article in Crisis Magazine called The Roots of Our Disrespect for Life. Thanks so much, Rob, for being with us.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
And blessings to all of you this week. Have a virtuous week ahead.
Tells me a different story. The voice of truth says, do not be